they record.
You are being recorded.
Okay, so so today, hello.
You can introduce yourself too.
So today I'll talk about eigenvalues and eigenfunctions for the Dirichlet Laplacian. And I guess some of you might be here because you're hoping to hear cool things like can we hear the shape of a drum? I'm not gonna do anything cool. I'm just gonna, like, all you're gonna get from me is some constraint optimization and, of course, the direct method of the calculus of variations. So yeah, sorry about that. I don't wanna assume anything for this talk, so I'm gonna just go back to, like, step one and define everything. If something is new to you, just feel free to ask. Okay, so we have omega containing our n to be a bounded over set. And I want to work mainly with two spaces. The first one is the space of square-integrable functions. So L to omega will be the set of functions f measurable, such that square integrable. So d to f squared over omega is finite.
And that's just with like Lebesgue measure.
Yeah, I mean it's Lebesgue measure. So f two has a nice ether structure, and the inner product is given by f g f two, just the integral of f against g, yes. And we will consider this space with the norm that is induced by this inner product, of course. Okay, to discuss the other space that we need for discussing the eigenvalue problem, let's consider first the C1C of omega, which will be the set of functions f C1 omega, such that the support of f is compactly contained in omega. And again, the support of f is just the closure of the set of points at which f is different from zero.
Does compactly contain omega?
That means that the support is a compact set in omega.
Oh, okay.
So you're far off from the boundary. Okay. Now, if we have f and g in C1, we can define the H1 norm. Or let's do the H1 inner product as G H1. This will be F against G plus the gradient of F against the gradient of G. So the H1 inner product looks like the L2 inner product plus the L2 inner product of the three integrated functions. And one can easily check that the space C1C of omega is not complete. With respect to the H1 norm. This is very easy to see. You can approximate functions like absolute value of x with smooth functions like
approximate absolute value of x with absolute value of 1 plus epsilon. And yeah, so it makes sense to consider the completion of this space with respect to that norm. And that's the other object that we're going to need for this talk. So we define h10 omega to be c1c omega closed with respect to this norm. Discuss the Laplace version in the end, so we need to talk about the derivatives. But solving the Laplace eigenvalue problem for like C2 function is really hard. So I need to cook up some spaces in which you'll be able to like do things without caring about regularity too much.
Okay.
Does that answer your question? Like we've
Why do we consider a new norm?
A new norm. So this space over here enjoys many cool properties that we need to do the analysis that we are gonna do later. So spoiler. This space embeds compactly into a tool. And we need this compactness to say something.
Okay.
So I'm just setting up the like spaces that I'm going to use. It shouldn't be clear why this is in any way related to the Laplacian version so far. Okay, so as I remarked before, the H1 norm is just a stronger norm than the L2 norm. So we immediately get that H10 of omega is contained in L2 of omega. And so what we're taking this space over here and we're adding some L2 functions to it, but not all of them. And we want to get a better grasp on what kind of functions are in this space, we have to discuss a little bit with derivatives. What is the idea of weak derivatives? So if we have a function f that is, say, c1, then for every function g, c1, c, everything is in omega. For every function g in omega, I have the integration by parts formula, which says that the partial derivative of f with respect to xj against g omega is equal to minus the integral over omega of f dg over dxj. I'm using integration by parts, and of course there is no boundary term because I'm assuming that g has support compact in omega. So g is 0 on the boundary. That's why the boundary term vanishes. So what is the clever idea that someone had at some point? If f is regular, this is always true. But the right-hand side of this equation doesn't require f to be any more regular than just integrable. So someone had the idea to say that if f is in L2, we can define its weak derivative with respect to xj as the, let me see, function h such that the integral of h so this is essentially
and this is for g's ranging over c1z.
Correct. Yeah. This is for every g ranging c1z. Yeah. Thank you. So what am I saying here? If f is more than f2, it's maybe c1. Then h is of course just the value of partial derivative. But actually, this relation might hold for functions that are not c1 but less smooth. Okay. So if we want to rewrite h1 using this notation, we actually end up getting the following characterization. It's not 100% precise, but it's good enough for the purpose of this. So h1 of omega is the set of all f in f2 such that there exists the weak gradient of f, according to that definition. The weak gradient of f is a square-integrable function, and here is where it's not entirely precise. F is 0 on the buffer omega. Why am I saying that this is not entirely precise? I'm saying something about an F2 function on a set of the back measure 0. So it's kind of a like it's a little bit delicate, but in some sense F is a little bit more than just an F2 function because it has a weak gradient. So somehow F remembers that it comes from a sequence of C1C functions. So it in some sense remembers that it has to stay like attached to zero on the boundary of omega. Okay, I hope this makes sense. Is there any questions so far? Good. The only other thing we need is the Laplace operator. So if say u is smooth enough, so C2. Then the Laplacian of u is defined as the sum over I from 1 to n. N is the dimension of the ambient space. V squared u over the xi squared. So it's the trace of the Hessian matrix for you. Okay. We're finally ready to consider the eigenvalue problem. And so I don't want to lie to you. I wrote in the abstract that I'm going to end up proving this spectral theorem for the Laplace operator. I'm not going to. Like, it's a little bit, I don't know. The time constraint doesn't allow me to, I guess. But we get close to it, I hope. But anyway. We will be able to like prove things that I don't know, maybe are interesting to you or not along the way. So the eigenvalue problem is so we look for pairs. And u is C2 function. was mentioning before, approaching this problem in this way is really harsh, and I actually don't know how to do it. Do I know how to do it? No, I don't know how to do it. Not for general me, at least. If a make is a square, then yeah, I know how to do it, but it's always it's not always a square. So the way to go here is to somehow find a weaker formulation for this problem. And that's the following one. So instead, we want to solve the following problem. So we look for a function u in h10 of omega such that the integral of the gradient of u against the gradient of v over omega is equal to lambda the integral over omega of u v. And this is, I want this relation to all for every v in h10 of v. I'm gonna call this problem w because it's weaker than the problem. Okay, but what do I mean exactly by weaker than the problem b? What I mean is that if we have a solution for problem b, then it's gonna be a solution for problem w. And this is actually very easy to prove and to go to right now. So proposition. If u and c2 omega solves p, then it solves w. Proof. So what do we know about u? We know that it satisfies this relation everywhere in omega. So fix any, so for every function v in c1 c omega, I will also have that Laplacian of u plus lambda u times v is equal to 0. Just because this is identically equal to 0. But then if this is true, nothing changes if I integrate this over omega. So then also the integral over omega of the function u plus lambda u times v is equal to 0. Now, okay, so we have that for every one of these, this is satisfied. Now, what do I want to do? I want to show that u satisfies this integral relation for every b in h10 of omega. So, fix b in h10 of omega, and let, remember what h10 is. It's the closure of c1t and the d1r. So, and let bk be in c1c of omega be such that bk converges to b in h1r. Right? I can always find such a sequence by definition of h1 and 0. Now, for every one of these bk, I have that this is satisfied. So I have that then d over omega fraction u plus lambda u bk is equal to 0. This is obviously equivalent to saying that integral over omega fraction u times bk is equal to minus lambda over omega UBK. And now what I can do is I can the divergence theorem with flux vk gradient of u, then you get that this is equal to minus the integral of gradient u dotted by gradient vk. So this is just integration by parts. Again, no boundary condition, no boundary integral, because I'm assuming that vk is equal to zero. Is everyone on board?
So the definition of Laplacian u is like that, right? Because u is in h 1, 0.
No, u is c2. If u is c2.
Ah, I see.
I'm proving that if it's a regular, like, I'm proving that p is like stronger than w. Like, if it solves p, then it solves w. Right? Okay. But what did I get here? Okay, there's a minus everywhere which I can get rid of. This shows that the integral over omega gradient u dot gradient vk is equal to lambda integral over omega of u vk. And now I just remembered that vk converges to v in the h1 norm. But that just implies that this goes to the integral over omega gradient u v, and this one will converge to the integral of u v. And that's exactly what I wanted. Remember that we're doing this for fixed v in h10, but like you can redo this process for every v in h10. So this shows that if u solves p, then it solves w. Make sense? Okay. I should mention that, somewhat surprisingly, the converse is also true. If u is a solution of the weak problem, then you can actually prove that it's not just h10, but you can prove that it's c infinity, and it actually satisfies the problem p. But this is very technical, it's regularity theory, I'm not gonna go into that, just to mention it. Solving the weaker problem is actually equivalent to solving the original problem. And this is frequently the way that people in PD approach these kind of problems. You go to a weaker version of your equation that it's easier to solve and like, prove existence, and then if you want a classical solution, you end up trying to prove that the weak solution that you have is actually regular enough to solve the classical problem. Okay. That being said, let's grab some low-hanging fruit. So we can prove very easily the thing that if u1 and u2, I should mention that from now on, every time I say eigenfunctions and eigenvalues, I mean of the problem w. I'm not going to talk about the regular problem anymore. So if u1 and u2 are eigenfunctions with eigenvalues lambda 1 and lambda 2 respectively, and if lambda 1 is different from lambda 2, then I get that u1 is orthogonal in L2 to u2. And also that the gradient of u1 is orthogonal to the gradient of u2 in L2. So eigenfunctions relative to different eigenvalues are orthogonal. And the proof of this is very easy. All we have to do is we want to use, so in the equation for ui, we want to use uj as a test function. So we have that both u1 and u2 satisfy this for every v in h10. So I want to use u2 as a test function for u1, and u1 as a test function for u2. Equation for u1 becomes integral over omega gradient u1 dot of the gradient of u2 is equal to lambda 1 integral over omega of u1 u2. And the second equation becomes integral over omega gradient u2 dot of the gradient of u1 is equal to lambda 2 integral over omega u2 u1. So if you do 1 minus 2, what you get is that these terms are the same, and then I have lambda 1 minus lambda 2 again, and I factor these together. So I get lambda 1 minus lambda 2 integral over omega of u1 u2 is equal to 0. But of course, by assumption, these two guys are different, then this one has to be equal to 0. But that one, what is it? It's exactly the L2 in the product. So then u1. If I want to get to this one, just look at equation 1. We have proved that these guys equal to 0, so this one is equal to 0. But that's the L2 inner product of the gradients, so that one is for free. Let's consider the following two functionals, and these are going to be functionals from h10 omega into R. And the first one, f of u, is defined as the integral over omega gradient u squared. So, in other words, this is just the L2 norm squared of the gradient of u, and g of u be defined as u squared dx minus 1. So this is just the L2 norm squared of u minus 1. Okay, and as we've seen a second, these two functionals have a very close relationship with the eigenvalue problem. So we have the following result. If u in h10 omega is a local extremum, so either local max or min, of f subject to the constraint. An application of the Lagrange multipliers theorem in the Banach space, calculus of variation kind of settings. And it goes like this. So if we have before starting the group, let me discuss briefly the setting. So if f and g are C1 functionals, on the band space, X, then an if X is a local extremum for f with g of x equal to 0. So these f and g here are not necessarily the same as there, but of course we will apply with f and g as there. And with x, h1, 0, omega. So the setting is exactly the same here. What we have is that for f, then if, what do I want to do? This is constraint optimization, right? So I want to say that the, in some sense, I want to say that the gradient of f has to be parallel to the gradient of g, right? That's the Lorentz multipliers. So I don't really have gradients in this case because we're looking at functions, not just function. So the result is the same, but we have first variations instead of gradients. And I'm gonna define first variations in a second. It's gonna be very intuitive, but just bear with me in a second. So if the first variations of g of x in the direction y is different from zero for some y in x, then number lambda r such that the first variation or the gradient of f evaluated x in the direction y is equal to lambda the gradient of g evaluated x in the direction y. Okay, so proof of the lemma. So let's apply this with f and g, that's the one that I have written here. So let's compute the first variation of f at u in the direction v. This is defined as exactly what you would expect it to be. This is the limit as epsilon goes to 0 of f of u plus epsilon v minus f of u over epsilon. So just a direction of the reasoning, but we're going in the direction of a function. For f, remember we have f is the epsilon norm of the gradient. So this is equal to the limit as epsilon goes to 0, 1 over epsilon. Let me write down what this is. So this is the integral over omega of the gradient of u plus epsilon gradient squared minus f of u, which is just the gradient of v. Now, if I expand the square here, I get gradient of u squared, which is going to cancel with this one. So, well, again, here it is. Then I have the double product, which is going to be 2 times gradient of u, 2 times epsilon, times gradient of u, inner product of the gradient of v. So 1 over epsilon, keep it to the second. So 2 epsilon prime u prime v. And then I have plus epsilon squared prime v squared. But then I can just simplify epsilon here. And when I take the limit, the first quantity stays here because there is no epsilon there. And this term over here vanishes because it has an epsilon. So that'll be equal to 2 times e to the omega grad u of w. Okay. The same computation can be done, it's actually easier to show that the the gradient of g at u in the direction v is just twice the inner product of uv. It's exactly the same combination. Okay, so what do we have now? Notice that if we plug in u as a direction here, we have the gradient of g at u in the direction of u is twice the input of u squared. But remember what we have in u. We have that g of u is 0. And by definition, g of u is the L2 norm of u minus 1. I don't know if you guys remember. That's how I defined g before. But this means that the L2 norm of u is 1. So, so this is just 2. And that's all I care about, because this is different from 0. So I can actually, like, I'm in a position to apply the theorem and get that then there exists a lambda such that this relation is satisfied. So what this means is that there exists lambda such that, let me just simplify the two right away, because there is a two, like, four systems in the product. This is exactly the eigenvalue equation, just written with the inner product notation. This is just integral of these guys. Okay, so what I've done, we have shown that if u is a lower extreme of f subject to this constraint, then it's an eigenfunction. Let's compute the eigenvalue. This is easy, because f of u is equal to, by definition, grad u, grad u. But this, by the equation, is equal to lambda u u. And now again, this is the L2 norm squared, which is again equal to 1. And this concludes the theorem. Okay. Almost there. One more interesting result. Let me fix this. I want to keep the statement, I guess. Yeah, I want to put the statement here. Theorem. There exists some such that u is a global minimizer. See where this is going. So we have that local extreme of f under this constraint are eigenfunctions with eigenvalue equal to f of u. What we're doing here is by showing that f has a global minimizer. A global minimizer is of course a local extreme, right? So we're gonna get an eigenfunction, but not just an eigenfunction. We're going to get the eigenfunction that is relative to the smallest eigenvalue. Because the eigenvalue is always equal to f of u, so we're minimizing f. So we're going to find the smallest eigenvalue here. Make sense? Alright. And yeah, that's where the fun part is. Couples of variations, yeah. So that proof. So let C, that's a C, let C be the functions W of H1 0 of omega such that G of W is things to notice. F is the integral of something squared, so F is always positive. So this number pi is going to be bounded below by zero, and it's not plus infinity because you can just plug in any C2 function into F and get a number. So I would be between zero and that number. So in particular, pi is a real number. Okay. So what we're gonna do now is, as I mentioned, the direct method of the Kakuzo variations, which is get an infimizing sequence. So let UK be such that F I want this in C. F of UK is less than or equal to I plus 1 over K. Now we're gonna use the properties of this page H1, space H10 to have compactness. I'm gonna write the sketch of the group here and I'm gonna check the details in a second. So we'll get compactness from embedding H10 of omega into compact embedding equal to 2. And since, again, we'll prove this, since F is weakly lower semi-continuous, then the limiting function U will be a global minimizer. I don't know, I guess this doesn't make much sense unless you have seen this once before, but I'm gonna do it right now. If you've seen this before, you know it's fine. Okay. Let's forget about this for a second. Awesome. We have this relation here. That means that the gradient of UK, L2 squared, is bounded by this number I plus 1 over k, but let me just go up and put 1 and have a uniform estimate for every k. So I thought I would do it before. I don't know. I don't remember if I did it or not. Have I talked about the Poincaré inequality or not? No, and Rayleigh theorem? Totally forgot about it. I'm sorry. I meant to do this after talking about H1. I guess I'll do it now. sorry about that. So, and this should probably answer your question. What do we care about these spaces? We have the following two parts. The first one, which actually I don't need, I don't know what the other is. There exists a constant C that only depends on omega, such that for every function f, H10 of omega, the integral of f squared can be controlled by this constant c times the integral of the gradient squared. If you have seen this before, you believe it, yeah.
Don't we just need weakly convergent subsequence? Right?
You mean what, like you're asking what we need Rayleigh's theorem?
Yeah.
You have to prove that the norm of U stays 1, otherwise the limit might not be in space.
Right.
So we need to do this.
Right.
Good question. Okay, I was going to say, you should believe this one, because what I'm saying is that I have a function f that is clamped on the boundary of omega at 0, and you have an estimate on the gradient. So the function cannot go to up or like to low. So you should expect to control this with the gradient. I hope this is intuitive enough. And two, we have Rayleigh's compactness theorem, which is what I stated there. H10 of omega embeds compactly into L2 of omega. The way we use this is that if we have a bounded sequence in H10, then it's going to have a subsequence that converges in that. That's what this means. Okay. Back to that. So we have that norm of UK L2 square is always equal to 1, because we're taking UK inside the set C, which is the point where G is equal to 0, and that means having L2 norm equal to 1. And we have that the gradient of UK is uniformly bounded. This means that the sequence UK is bounded in H1 or in H10. This implies that then, by Rayleigh's theorem, before I'm gonna just take a weakly convergence of sequence. So this is a sequence that's bounded in a Hilbert space. Then up to a subsequence, it has it converges to some function in this space with respect to the weak topology of this space, right? So then it is H10 in Hilbert. There exists UKJ. It's usually the other way around, right? That converges weakly to U in H10. And this sequence, of course, enjoys the same bounds because it's just a subsequence. And there I can use this Rayleigh's compactness theorem to say that there exists a further subsequence that UKJN that converges strongly to U in that. And it has to be the same U, and you don't put that easy. Okay, what do you want to do with this? So, that's all about compactness. Now that we have this point of U, we want to prove that this U is actually the global minimizer. And if you remember, of course you do. If you remember Weierstrass theorem, like existence of maximum and minimum, all you need for your function to have a minimum is lower semi-continuity, right? Because you just need to go down and see, you know what I'm talking about. So let's do that for this case. Claim first. This is the lower semi-continuity of the norm, yes. The norm of U in H1 is less than the minimum norm of U. So let me abuse notation and relabel everything. Like this last subsequence that converges nicely is just going to be UK. Just simplify this one forward there. Okay, so that proves the claim. Now for to finish off the proof, since U K converges to U Gravina 2, then the norm of U Gravina 2 squared has to stay equal to 1. And this is all we need for the function U to be in the set, remember the set C. So this means that then U belongs to C. And the reason why I need this is that then I can say that I is less than or equal than f of u. I is the minimum of f over c, so that's why. But now what do I have? I have f of u is equal to gradient u squared for omega. And I can write this one as gradient of u squared plus or minus u squared over omega. So the first term, u gradient of u plus u squared, is it's just the H1 norm. So I have H1 norm, so this is equal to H1 norm of U squared minus L2 norm of U squared. And by using the claim over there, I get that this thing is less than or equal than the mean as k equals to infinity of U k H1 squared minus UK L2 squared. Here, I'm using that I have strong convergence here to put together limit and limit. Right? You will be allowed to break the limit when one of them is actually converging. Okay? So, what this gives me is that this quantity here looks exactly like this one, but with the K. So, that is equal to the limit as k goes to infinity of d equal over omega of just gradient of uk. Because the L2 norm part, they just cancel. But now what is this? This is just f of uk. And what do I know on f of uk? I know that it's less than or equal than, let me copy the limit. I know that this that is below I plus 1 over k. Oh, but this is equal to I. So this shows that f of u is equal to I. And this means that the mean, the infimum is achieved and u is a global minimizer. Okay, this is great. So we proved the theorem. I have something like 15 minutes left, so I'm just going to do this. Okay, as I remarked before, what we have now is an eigenfunction of the Laplace eigenvalue problem with eigenvalue that is as small as possible, because we have that u is a global minimizer. So the standard notation in this case is to call this lambda 1 and this u. Something that I want to remark very quickly is that f of cu is equal to c squared f of u. So then, in particular, we have that f of u over the norm of u in L2 squared is equal to f of u over norm of u in L2. So actually, minimizing f over the constraint that the L2 norm is 1 is the same as minimizing this quotient. So lambda 1, which is the minimum, I'm about to write minimum now because I proved that it's actually achieved, that the minimum of u in C of f of u is equal to the minimum of u in h1 0. I'm removing that the L2 norm is 1 of d equal over omega radius squared over d in software is pretty much a compact way of writing this limitation problem. Okay. So what if we want to find the next smallest eigenvalue? So what we do is we define x1 to be u1 orthogonal. So this is the set of both u and h1 0 omega such that u in the product between u1 is 0. Now, this is a closed condition. This space is closed and it's a Hilbert space again. So you can pretty much repeat the exact same analysis that we did with x1 in place of x. X was h1, 0. And if you do the same analysis, you will find a number 2 that will be the infimum or minimum. It's the same. Over all u in x1, such that u will be u squared. And you can repeat this process by just adding u2 here, and then you define x3. And in general, you get that lambda, say m plus 1, is the infimum over u in xn of the Rayleigh quotient. Okay, so we have a non-decreasing sequence of eigenvalues. And to each of these eigenvalues, we can associate an eigenfunction that has L2 norm 1. Note that I'm not saying that the eigenspace has dimension 1. Like, I'm not using that anywhere. Like, I'm not going to need this for a false. Is that even true? So for each eigenvalue, we can find an eigenfunction. And by the way we have defined this, all of these eigenfunctions are going to be orthogonal to each other, because we look for every one in the orthogonal complement of the space. OK, so the last result for today is going to be the following theorem. The limit as n goes to infinity of lambda n. So as I said, this is an increasing sequence, so or non-decreasing at least. So the only way this is not true is that if they are uniformly bounded. So suppose by contradiction that there exists a number m such that lambda n is that circle than m for every n. Okay, then the norm of grad un in L2 squared, using the eigenvalue equation, this is equal to lambda n norm of un L2 squared. But this is just equal to 1, so this is lambda n. And this is uniformly bounded by n. So again, I have that the gradients are uniformly bounded. And since also the L2 norm is bounded by 1, because they're exactly equal to 1, then I have that un is bounded in h1, 0 again. And what this allows me to do again is to use the Rayleigh compactness theorem to find a convergent subsequence. Just this implies that then U and K is a Gaussian sequence. And in particular, this shows that U and K minus U and K plus 1, we have 2 squared. This one has to go to 0 as K goes to infinity. But remember that these functions are orthogonal to each other. So if you use Pythagorean theorem on this one, this is just equal to U and K at 2 squared minus twice U and K plus 1 plus U and K plus 1 at 2 squared. Now, they're orthogonal, so this is 0, and this is 1, and this is 1. So this quantity has to stay constant too, so it cannot go to 0. So what is not verified is that there exists such an angle. And this proves that the sequence of eigenvalues blows up. As I thought, I'm not gonna have time to prove the spectral theorem, but I think it's worth it, just write it down. It says that theorem for any and okay, this is I think to justify all the work that we've done, like let's see some useful application of what it means. So for any f in L2 omega, we can write f as the sum of m from 1 to infinity of alpha n un, where alpha n is the absolute number. The proof of this is just so do it for f smooth enough at first, and then prove it for every f in L2 by approximating it. So you first do it for f in h10, because you wanna be able to say something about the derivatives of f. And what you do is like you do estimates on the truncation error, so f minus the sum up to n. You want to prove that this goes to zero now, so. Okay, yeah. I think that's all. Do you guys have questions? Yeah.
Wait, so just for this this spectral theorem thing, does it not work just to, so we peeled off the smallest eigenvalue, and we take the orthogonal complement, peel off the next smallest eigenvalue, we have these increasing eigenvalues.
Right.
And so if that didn't span the whole space, couldn't we just continue the process?
So it's an infinite process, right? Mm-hmm. Like you got a sequence. So what you're saying is that
I guess my intuition, like
right now.
I'm probably thinking too naively, but my intuition is that since you have this increasing eigenvalues condition,
mm-hmm.
that says like one pass through this process should span the whole space.
Yeah, that's what we do exactly. Like you do this once, like you go, just keep going, and of course you're not gonna end up if you do it in like because it's like what we're aiming for is a solid basis, right? It's a countable basis. So yeah, what you're saying is that just pick this sequence of eigenvalues and. Look at like one eigenfunction and those like would form a basis for you. And I'll take your question.
I think
okay. Any other questions? Comments? Suggestions?
you are just think about just interval, then that is going to be just cosine and sine.
Right. Yeah. You can write this as sine and sine. Yeah. And in that case, you can play around with boundary conditions even better. Like you can do it for example.